Again, we are so lucky to have all four panelists here, and they have all agreed that the panel can be recorded so that we can have it for our archives and for educational purposes. And is there anyone here, if during the question and answer period you ask the question, is there anyone here who does not want to be videotaped? Okay. Okay. Somebody, you don't want to be? Oh, did you see?
He knows.
He knows. Oh, okay, fine. Okay, so let's get started with our panel. We'll have, each one has maybe up to 10 minutes or so, and then we'll be, then after the panel presentation, we'll open it up for question and answers. Usually we're out by about 4:30 or 4:45. You're welcome to stick around for a few minutes if you like to continue talking. Anyway, so let me introduce our panelists. First of all, I'll go in the order of the presentation. First of all, we have Armando Robles, who is, who was and still is the president of UE Local 1110. And he is the person who, as you saw, led the occupation in Republic Windows. And of course, there was a lot of assistance from other people, but what a wonderful leader you were. Mr. Robles works as a maintenance worker in the same plant, which opened with a new owner, Sirius Materials, from California, and has continued to recognize the union contract. So thank you, Armando. Tim Curtin, thank you, was one of the many UE staff members who assisted the local in the occupation of Republic Windows. He has been a member of UE since 1974, and he has worked on national staff since 1977. And I think you were involved in these particular negotiations, right?
No, I helped work with the security team and kept the lawyers and people out of the door.
Okay.
And filming.
and the occasional troublemaker with a camera.
Okay.
We let the good guys in.
That brings us to Andrew Friend, our filmmaker. He works as a videographer in Chicago. His Emmy-nominated work has appeared on PBS and other Chicago television stations. Friend has produced several half-hour episodes for the nonprofit Midwest TV show Labor Beat, and he has served as a chairman. So again, we're glad to have Tim with us. And I believe you have some copies available for sale at $20 if you want to help support the effort. And finally, we have Carrie Leiterson. Carrie Leiterson is a Chicago-based journalist, author, and journalism instructor. In 2009, she published Revolt on Goose Island, which we have here, the Chicago factory takeover and what it says about the economic crisis. She is also the author of a 2005 book on immigration from Latin America and co-author of the 2008 book, Shoot an Iraqi, Art, Life, and Resistance Under the Gun. She writes for the Washington Post, the New York Times, and other outlets, and teaches journalism at Columbia College. So let's give a big hand for all of our panelists.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's my pleasure to be here in Longport. You see, majority of the stuff happened during 2008. The thing is, I would like to say, it was not as spontaneous. We don't decide to occupy the company just because they suggest us or we think about. It was for years and years repression from the company. And at the end, when the company decided to shut the doors and give us anything, is when we get the courage and we was afraid to do it, but we don't have anything else to lose, so we run the risk. After the occupation, the guy from California, he has the company in Sanibel, California. They make EcoRack, the drywall, but it's a high efficient windows, soundproof. He called me at the union hall. He was looking for me to find a way how to buy the company. We invited him to come to Chicago. he come the day before my birthday. We invited him, we introduced him to people from the bank who was the bank trustees, and we invited him to come to the company to see the equipment. When he see the equipment, he was really, really excited because the company has, before the company closed the doors, I take pictures from the equipment, and it was just from three parts. It's four quadrants in the company, and just take pictures from just three quadrants because I don't have enough time to down with the other one. And I have like 340 machines, pictures for each machine, one picture for each machine. It was around 340 machines. So the company stole just like 15, like around 20 machines and 10 trailers. So it was not a, it was a, it's a huge company. It's a lot of machine in the company. So when he saw all this equipment, he was really excited. He told us, you know what, I could pay pennies per dollar because it was a bankruptcy. At the end, we introduced him to the government department, the bank, and the company to see the equipment. And he bought the company on February the 26th. We fight for a contract, a new contract to us with the union and the new company. We want our same salary. We want our same seniority from Republic. He can't hire no one else until he recruit the 274 UA members of 1110 affected in 2008. And actually, we are 38 workers back. The reason is the first it was the cleaning of the company. We take like 3 months cleaning, throwing stuff, putting the company on right place, and then try to certify the quality of the windows, because we can't just produce the windows. We know how to do the high quality, but the thing is, the government demand to the company that has to be certified for the government requirements and send all the stuff to a laboratories on another states, so they have to send each product to the labs and make so many tests and everything. And some of those tests has to pass the extremely heat and extremely cold. And it takes some like 6 months of heat and 6 months of cold. So it takes time to be approved. We are in that process, we're still in that process. And the good thing is they make efficient windows. As we in Republic, we made just vinyl. We made new construction, which is not more new constructions in the whole country because the economy, the construction is stopped, is off. We was making replacement windows with Republic, with Sirius. Now we made fiberglass. It's a new product we are starting introducing now. Replacement windows and commercial windows, which is the new project. They start making like 8 months, 9 months ago, they start with the Empire State Building. They already done with the work. They replaced the whole windows from Empire State Building in New York. And they was having the project, they was talking about the Willis Tower replacement. But the thing is, they don't have the stimulus yet because they need like $300 million to replace the whole windows, and it's kind of hard to get the financial. And they have some issues. Like, well, we met with the owner two weeks ago, and he told us that they don't want to replace yet the windows because it's some kind of the building is some kind of a crack, something like. And I go outside and I tell him, you know what? What is the crack? What is the crack? I don't see anything. So at the end, I think it's the financial. It's not what he told us, it's the financial stuff. And but he tried to make fun, so something like that. So we expect next year have more more sales. We have contracts with Lowe's. We have a lot of projects right now, and we expect to bring more people back to probably next year. We have meeting yesterday with our co-workers who are unemployed yet right now. We have a meeting with all of our co-workers. Some of the one day they decide to come to the meeting. We put an update what has happened in the company, and they are waiting for the, and we expect to bring more work to the company and have everybody back to work. Thanks.
Wow.
I'll just sit if that's okay. A couple of things, and if anybody, Mark Meinster said it, but I'll repeat it. In the UE, the members run the union, and if there's any question about whether they can handle it, after anybody hears Armando Robles, you understand that's the proper tactic. You know, unfortunately, what's happened in an awful lot of organized labor is we spend a lot of time fighting amongst ourselves. Less than 10% of manufacturing is organized in this country anymore. And there are turf wars that continue to go on in the AFL-CIO, which, of course, is crazy. There's still the bulk of the workforce is unorganized. Right now, the UE in the Chicago area, we're out organizing in the southwest suburbs. If you go out along I-55 and you go where I-55 meets 294, keep going west up to Bolingbrook and Joliet, you'll see hundreds of warehouses. Okay, and what they do now is no manufacturing place and certainly no retail stores have any warehouses anymore. They have these just-in-time deliveries. And these places are filled with the workforce that looks just like Republic Windows and Doors, now Serious Materials. They're largely immigrant workers or poor whites. Over half of them are temporary, which means no benefits, minimum wage. We've actually helped people file a couple of wage and hours. They were paying people by the piece on unloading trucks. They weren't even paying minimum wage. You know, and there are probably upwards of 20 to 30,000 workers out in that area. So that's the latest UE project. We're calling it Warehouse Workers for Justice. And we, to us, you have to organize. If you don't organize, first of all, it gives power. We also continue to service shops. I was at that meeting yesterday. The staff person that had been servicing the shop, Leah Freed, who's in the movie, she just had a child a week and a half ago. So I'm filling in over there. But what I think, if it's all right with you, I think we ought to share a little bit about the frustration that the people have, because it's the economy that is killing the right of our members to go back to work. So we look at it as a union, as a UE, you have to fight for political justice and political action. One of the things that we did, let me just finish and then I'll answer your question, okay? We just had 30 of our UE locals from around the country in Washington. Every other year we have a political action conference. Now, we don't give politicians money. First of all, we don't have any. But if we had any money, we wouldn't give it to them anyway.
Yes.
We go into the office and we demand to meet with the folks, and we tell them that, look, we put you in, and we can take you out. And the staff doesn't do that. It's rank and file leaders like Armando. He had two members from his local there. And that's the way we do political action, because the people, and that's, you know, part of our frustration is that we have to get off of our butts and organize if we're gonna take this country back, whether you're in a labor union or a situation where you're still working and not in labor union. You have to take the country back. And it's going to require the kind of actions that they took in Republic, and it's going to take political action and organizing wherever we are economically and politically. So appreciate getting the invite, and anybody that wants more information on Warehouse Workers for Justice, see me at the end. Sister back here had a question.
Yeah, we'll take this one, but if you'll hold the rest of them off until after the panel is completed.
I hate to show my ignorance, but I've heard anything from $3.25 to $8.25 as the minimum wage in this country. So could you clarify what the minimum wage is?
It's 8 1/4 here right now. It's a buck higher than it is in neighboring states. In fact, one of the issues people are going to vote on is the guy Brady wants to take a buck back, so we'll make what they make in Indiana. So the issue of minimum wage or having a living wage, which other people in this room have fought for, is a huge issue.
Well, you've already seen my presentation, so I won't talk for too long. There were really only two regrets I had about the film, and it all involves what you were saying, I guess, talking about the workers that, you know, that have not yet gotten back to work. You know, somebody saw the ending and said, like, that's totally deceptive. That's not really what's going on. There's only 40 of them back there. And I'm like, well, it says, you know, when production begins, this isn't going to happen. You know, but in any case, it's as a filmmaker, it's a little frustrating to not have a story get fully wrapped up with a big, neat bow. And that there's a long, sort of drawn-out ending. But I feel like eventually, you know, everybody's going to go back. I know in the film, the four main people that I spoke with in the film, of those, Armando and Ricky are back at work. Ricky's there, are back at the factory. But Raul and Rocio are not. I think Rocio's getting, she works in a restaurant or something like that right now.
Actually, right now he's working on one place where they made a dress for quinceañeras.
Okay.
She find a better job.
Okay, gotcha. The other regret I have is that in having to edit things down to fit into a 60-minute time frame, I did have to speed up kind of the long ramp up to this occupation. And in the final version of the film, it does kind of look like they just thought this up right there in the week leading up to the occupation, and they told me nice long stories about how they organized their union in the first place back in 2004 when they were fighting against the company then, and how long they always had to fight against the company in the ensuing years, and how it was actually about 3 or 4 weeks once they realized the equipment was missing before the occupation happened, and during that 3 weeks they were organizing behind the scenes and that kind of stuff. You know, and that stuff, I try to put as much of that in the film as possible because I did want the film to be sort of a guide to, like, here's how you do this at your workplace, right? But I didn't want to bog it down with so many details that it didn't, you know, it wasn't a fun little adventure film as well. You know, that's why I kind of took out some of those details. But I think that it still kind of gives you the idea of, like, what you got to do. I was telling someone earlier who asked a question. We only have not-for-profit screen rights and you know, giving it up for donations and that kind of stuff for the current music in the film, so we're going to have to redo the music in order to get it sort of nationally out there. But that part is almost done, and we'll probably shoot for, you know, PBS and other kinds of things like that. I just consider myself really lucky that I got to, you know, when I went into it, I just thought I was covering a story for Labor Beat. I figured this thing would be over in one day, and that it was going to have a sad ending. I figured, you know, we were going into this massive, 700,000 people had just lost their jobs in 1 month. I was just like, this is not going to end well. Sometimes you can get inspiration from, sources that you hadn't expected it, and so, you know, in a time in my life when I really needed some inspiration, 260 odd workers at this glass factory, they showed, you know, what's possible, what you can do. So I'll just answer any questions you guys have during the Q&A, but that's all I have to say.
So I was covering, obviously, the occupation as a journalist, and then it turned into this publisher in New York, Melville House, actually asked me to do a really quick book, I think on the first or second day of the occupation. So they were kind of, you know, both lucky, I guess, and smart in seeing that this, you know, would turn into a story that would really resonate with the public. And not to, you know, toot the horn of my own profession too much, but the media did play a really important role in this whole situation, both the alternative and labor media, and then also the mainstream media. And there's a lot of really interesting things you could say about why that came about. You know, it's kind of a given, obviously, that the labor media and the progressive media would cover it, and did an excellent job, and, you know, had all the background about struggles in Argentina and other worker takeovers around the world, you know, in recent times and historically, and all the background about the UE. And, you know, I thought the alternative media did an excellent job. And then also just social media, if I understand right, actual news of the occupation really spread. I'm not a big social media person myself, but from what I've heard, it, you know, really Facebook and you know, all the different social media forums played a real big role in letting people know about it. But that happens, you know, with a lot of the labor alternative and social media parts happen with a lot of labor struggles. And, you know, the community support in this struggle was really, really crucial, because, like so many cases now, since labor has been, labor's official power, you know, has been so gutted for a whole number of reasons, a lot of times it does come down to kind of public image and public support, you know, in determining how a given situation actually turns out. And that was especially the case here, since the company was closing. You know, it's not like it was a contract. There was the Warren Act, which the company did violate. But, you know, even when companies violate laws, it's usually a long, drawn-out process to actually get any restitution through the courts. So it really was all the public support and public image ramifications that made Bank of America and actually Chase also put up this money. And they really didn't have any legal obligation to do so. So, you know, they made the, after the occupation and all the outpouring of support and pressure from politicians, even, they made the, you know, the judgment that it was worth their money to, you know, to ultimately do the right thing. So the public, you know, the people that were the union members and you know, activists and people around the city were gonna find out about this, and we're gonna come out to support it regardless. But in terms of really getting, I mean, that's true for, you know, many, many labor struggles each year. What was really unusual about Republic Windows was the mainstream media, which for the most part usually ignores labor, really hooked, really grabbed on to this story. And, you know, made it this, and it was kind of funny in some ways to see how it was treated as if, you know, there's not dramatic labor stories all the time, which they always ignore. And then suddenly the media, the mainstream media, got really into this story, which was amazing. And I think it wasn't an accident. It was really a testament to the brilliant strategizing of UE, and then also just how sympathetic and incredible the workers are. And then, it, you know, it helped that it came right before Christmas. It was right after the bailouts, and UE, you know, just had this incredible idea in pegging it, in portraying it, and pegging it as this larger symbol of people's anger about the bailouts and of the whole economic crisis, you know, as opposed to getting mired in, you know, the details of the Republic Windows business situation. And I'm talking in terms of, you know, their dealings with the media. I mean, even Fox, you know, was doing sympathetic stories to the workers, which is like incredible. So I think both types of media played a really, really important role. And the part that's disappointing to see is how, and not unexpected, but, you know, since then, even though the mainstream media got so much mileage out of this story, there's continued to be, you know, really weak and non-existent coverage of labor in the years since then. It's not like there doesn't seem to have been, you know, any lessons learned. Like, labor stories are really great stories. We should cover them more. And there's a lot of reasons for that. I mean, media itself has suffered probably more than almost any, you know, individual industry in the crisis, for reasons even aside from the larger economic crisis. There's been a huge percentage of, you know, full-time media workers laid off in the past 2 years. So there just aren't the people to do in-depth stories and labor stories like there were in the past. You know, again, I'm talking mainstream media, which for a lot of reasons, you know, does reach, I mean, people that know to seek out labor in alternative media find it, but you know, there's a huge chunk of our population that doesn't see that stuff, even though they should. So, you know, it takes getting something on the nightly news or you know, in the mainstream daily paper for a lot of the public to know about it. So anyway, yeah, I mean, the state of media coverage of labor aside from Republic Windows is really lacking and unfortunate right now. And, you know, I think a lot of struggles that should have come out differently, including one that UE did that was pretty similar in a lot of ways to Republic Windows in the Quad Cities in the 6 months or so after Republic Windows. Was that yours? Okay, so yeah. I mean, a lot of the factors
Quad
were the
City
same.
Podcast.
Yeah, but, you know, and you probably have insight into why it didn't get the media and public support. I guess be a whole other conversation, but you know, the media didn't really, and partly it wasn't in Chicago. There weren't as many, you know, national and international reporters already based there. So that was just one example of, you know, how I think mainstream journalists really dropped the ball and not continuing, even if they don't sympathize with the workers necessarily, just continuing their pursuit of a good story, you know, that they saw with Republic Windows. And there was just one other point I wanted to make. Well, I guess one way that can, you know, since the mainstream media world has been fracturing so much, I think alternative media and blogs and all these other forms and community journalism, you know, people who aren't trained, paid journalists doing their own media and getting it out there, I mean, that those forms of media have gotten a lot more prominence and I think importance, partly because mainstream media has been shrinking and you know, kind of collapsing. So I would hope at least that, you know, the more other forms of media and citizen journalists show an interest in labor stories and really cover labor stories on their own, you know, theoretically you would hope that that would show that even though large media organizations have to be even more frugal with their resources, you know, they'll decide that covering labor stories are important, affect everyone, are great stories. One of the other interesting things about the media coverage of Republic Windows is, you know, even though, I mean, pretty much everyone, unless you're retired or young, you know, is a worker, but for some reason a lot of people don't identify themselves as workers, and I think during the Republic Windows struggle, people started to realize, you know, oh wait, I'm a worker just like they are, and a lot of solidarity was really quickly bred, you know, that we haven't seen in the past. So anyway, I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you.